There it is. I open it from there. Maybe it's corrupt. Maybe it's corrupt. I don't think so. But maybe. Let's try it. Let's go to plan B.
Okay.
I'm glad I brought both. I'll take a USB. To 1,000 cadets at West Point.
I knew that was going to happen. I didn't know that there were so many, but I guess that'll be rather different from this.
I think so, although, like, one of the things Françoise went up with her, and I'm bursting to know what happened, because they both came back really moved by what happened. Like, it was intense. So I figured if I didn't get told before, it could become part of our conversation.
Well, it surely should, yeah. I think, because I'm sure very relevant to the general subject of the foreign exchanges series and all that we've been talking about in connection with the festival and everything. So anyway, thanks so much for doing this. We're delighted, finally able to get you in a program or in something or other.
I'm glad, yeah.
So are we.
Il y a Bécassine et il y a Castafiore. Oui, oui. Et ni l'une ni l'autre.
En France et aux États-Unis, il y a très peu.
Il y a pratiquement rien.
Oui. Il y a aussi une certaine violence.
Exactement, exactement.
Qui est très masculine.
Exactement, exactement. Et donc, ça a fait qu'il y a moins de femmes qui en ont lu, certainement, et qui en ont fait. Parce qu'il faut les. Moi, c'est un peu bidon, parce que moi, j'étais pas une lecteur de bande dessinée. Je suis arrivée dans un atelier de bande dessinée, et c'est vraiment comme par hasard, j'avais mes amis qui étaient là, qui étaient tous des hommes d'ailleurs, qui me disaient vas-y.
David B, est-ce que vous l'avez connu par la suite ou
David B, je le connaissais, mais j'étais dans un atelier où lui, il n'était pas. Enfin, il y avait d'autres dessinateurs qui étaient là, et tous mes amis, ils étaient là, mais. Fait quelque chose avec cette histoire, mais au lieu d'être bouffé par cette histoire de l'intérieur, faisant quelque chose. Et en fait, c'est mes amis qui m'ont poussé. Et le métier, je l'ai appris des hommes. C'est-à-dire vraiment, j'avais tous mes amis qui étaient là à regarder les planches et à me dire, mais Marjane, tu sais, là, il faut pas faire comme ça. Et ils m'ont vraiment beaucoup, beaucoup aidé. Donc j'ai vraiment appris le métier sur le champ.
L'écriture est très féminine, en fait.
L'écriture, oui. L'écriture, c'est la mienne. Mais après, dans la façon de faire, c'est... Voilà.
Mais est-ce que vous avez appris à dessiner normalement?
Oui.
Représenter la
chose quand même. Oui. Enfin, moi, non seulement j'ai dessiné toute ma vie, mais en plus j'ai eu une éducation. Enfin, j'ai étudié l'art toujours. J'ai fait une maîtrise en Iran. J'ai étudié les arts décoratifs et tout. Voilà. Donc c'était pas.
Voilà.
Voilà. Donc c'est pas venu de nulle part non plus.
Mais est-ce que vous croyez pouvoir développer encore votre style visuel?
Ah oui, c'est-à-dire
bon, vous avez commencé par là, mais par la suite, vous n'avez plus besoin de cette tradition. Vous pouvez évoluer dans un autre.
Mais bien sûr, mais là, par exemple, je suis en train de faire un film de Persepolis, un film d'animation qui est en noir et blanc. C'est pour le cinéma, c'est un film d'animation, mais être directeur de film, ça n'a rien à voir avec le fait de faire un livre. Donc évidemment, pour moi, toutes sortes en fait d'expressions, peu importe la forme, c'est bon. À partir du moment où ça me convient suffisamment pour que je m'exprime, ça peut être ça ou autre chose. C'est, pour moi, c'est du pareil au même. And once in a while, I will call
it. Go to the mothership.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Turn.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Michael Roberts, Executive Director of Penn American Center, and I'm pleased to welcome you to this fifth in a series of Penn programs dedicated to opening just a few tiny cracks in the very substantial barriers that insulate most American readers from writing and thinking coming from abroad. I think that there are probably many of you here who have attended some of the 40-odd programs that we've had a few weeks ago in our Penn World Voices International Festival of Literature, including a number of wonderful programs here at the New School with the co-sponsorship of the Graduate Writing Program. So I won't repeat the astonishingly depressing statistics about how few of the voices that Americans need to hear from abroad are actually making it through that almost impenetrable barrier. But that festival was actually a kind of gigantic exfoliation from the Foreign Exchanges series, of which this is the fifth, which we launched just over a year ago. And we've already brought writers from Nigeria, Iran, Guatemala, and China to New York for conversations with American writers or U.S.-based authors. We very much wanted Marjane Satrapi to be with us for the festival, but her schedule didn't permit it. But we're delighted to continue foreign exchanges with her, and we're very grateful to the Graduate Writing Program and its director, Robert Polito, for co-hosting this program with us tonight. Our evening is a real trifecta for Penn, with all three of our participants, believe it or not, actually born abroad. And all are now in very interesting ways stirring up an exciting New York and American cultural life, as well as many other parts of the world. Supremely, of course, they've helped to dissolve another kind of barrier, the one that used to try to separate written from illustrated literature. Françoise Mouly was born in Paris and moved to New York in 1974. 3 years later, with her husband Art Spiegelman, she co-founded Raw Books and Graphics, and in 1980, the pioneering avant-garde comics anthology, also known as Raw. Since 1993, she's been art editor at The New Yorker and is now cover art editor for that magazine. In 2000, she published Covering The New Yorker and has curated international exhibitions devoted to cover art. Marjane Satrapi was born in 1969 in Rasht, Iran, and now lives in Paris. Her Persepolis and its sequel, Persepolis II, introduced hundreds of thousands of Americans to a view of contemporary Iran that was both simpler and immensely more complicated than anything they had seen previously. In the best tradition of literature, it humanized and complicated the crudities of geopolitics and made us see a rich and vital part of the world and its complexities as we had not done before. Her new book is Embroideries, about which we'll hear more tonight. Art Spiegelman's influence on the comics world has been described as a blend of Michelangelo and the Medici, but what you may not know is that he was born in Stockholm. Fortunately, he rejected his parents' suggestion to become a dentist. Having won numerous awards for his work, including the Pulitzer Prize for Mouse, A Survivor's Tale, he's now working with composer Philip Johnston on an opera about the history of comics entitled Drawn to Death, a three-panel opera His latest book is In the Shadow of No Towers. Art has asked me to announce that due to a medical condition, he is required to smoke. So I hope you'll all be patient. To serve as our moderator tonight, welcome, please, Françoise Mouly.
Thank you very much. And thank you for welcoming, the bastard offspring of literature, two of the, I think, most interesting cartoonists working these days. I brought in a few visuals, not knowing if everybody was familiar with Marjane's work or with art. So this is a cover of the first Persepolis. A book was published in France in 2000 and 2001, and here in 2003. 2003 was the gathering of the first two volumes in the story of her childhood, and it tells of her life as a child in Iran, and her personal growing up. This page, for example, shows her conversation with God and her confusion or identification of God with a picture of Marx, since they both have big beards. And she also talks about the revolution in Iran in 1979 and the consequences on her and on her family. And in the first volume, you see coming of age of a young child in a culture that is at war, actually, and the impact on Marjane's family. In the second Persepolis, her parents sent her to Europe. She went to Vienna at the age of 14. And discovered Western culture, and here she's showing us a first encounter with parties and people making out and smoking, and then a return to also like being ostracized as being from a foreign country and the stereotypes that were projected onto her, as well as what happened to her when she went back to Iran and where she studied art as a young woman. And the point of view that Marjane shows is at least as it tells us at least as much about Western culture as it tells us about Iran. And the point of view is shifting, as she is, between languages, between countries. In embroideries, which I learned today, she drew in between the two volumes of Persepolis. She's specifically focusing on women in Iran. After dinner, the men leave and the women come together around the samovar that Marjane was in charge of as a child, and exchange stories, and are very frank and direct about their feelings about arranged marriages, the requirement to be a virgin in that culture. Embroideries is the term used for medical procedure where the vagina is resewn tighter so that the woman can pretend to be a virgin. And she uses a different kind of graphic approach of no panel to panel, but different balloons coming from all the assembled people to give you the feeling that you are in the same room with all the women exchanging stories. There is, I'm delighted to be moderating between two very articulate people, the other one being my husband, Art Spiegelman, who I think needs very little introduction, certainly to me. But his work describes his parents' life in World War II and his relationship with his father, and his difficulty and his interest in representation. This is his ideas of how he would draw me, actually, in Mouse, and a discussion between the Art Mouse and the Françoise Mouse about the fact that in real life I don't ever let him talk. So he also is the author of In the Shadow of No Towers, which is a series of strips that he did after 2001, which focus on his reaction to what he lived through and how he feels that was used into a different narrative. I think that's the end. So we can turn this off now. Unless you want to go back to any specific picture. We can, again, I have no problem eliciting either of you to talk, but one topic we could start with is in Persepolis, Marjane, let me see if I can take it off from here. Yes. Yes. Now I can sit back. In Persepolis, especially in the first book, you have talked about the fact that you wanted to teach, that there was a didactic impulse that made you want to do the book. I know that that Art had different response to that question. So could you address what you wanted to do and what you set out to accomplish when you did Persepolis, and then I'll ask Art?
Well, you know, Persepolis actually was not a story that one of a sudden I said to myself, oh, I'm going to write a story about my life in Iran. It was really something that came slowly by slowly. I mean, all the story I have been telling them in an oral way to all the people, but they are not made in this way. I mean, they were not structured in this way. But I was talking all the time because it was so many misjudgments about Iran, and me coming from there, looking at all these things and saying to myself, oh my God, is that about my country they are talking? And this is absolutely not the way I saw it. And then you know that this is this famous Italian writer that, of course, I don't remember his name, who said that for him, writing was the only way to talk without being interrupted. And probably that was my goal of writing Persepolis, that was to be able to write it, the book, to write it and to tell the story once and forever. And the reason I chose my personal story to say that was not, to say, oh, look at me, how cute I was when I was a child, and it was so great. It was not that. It was that I don't consider myself, and I am not actually, I'm not a historian, and I'm not a politician, and I'm not a sociologist. I'm none of that. But I am born in a certain place at a certain time, and I have seen things. And I can have doubt about whatever. Something I don't have any doubt about is about what I saw with my own eyes. So it happened that I saw a revolution, it happened that I saw a war, and then I wanted to tell the story. Then the problem is, of course, you know, when you talk about memories, of course, you know, 14 years of my life, you cannot put it in 360 pages of comics, otherwise my life would be very meaningless. So I had to really choose a few moments that really could make this bridge between the two cultures. Actually, not so much the differences of the cultures, but the resemblance between the two cultures. And that is what I think that is the importance of the anecdote in the story. That means when you say the story of a whole nation is an abstract notion. It doesn't mean anything, a whole nation. But when it comes to the story of one person with some small anecdote that it can look like nothing, but a small anecdote can describe much more. And that is what I try to do. I don't say that I have completely succeeded to doing it, but I try to take the moment of life that anybody could relate to in order to make them understand the most possible. So that was how it came.
And how would you answer the question as to what was your impulse in doing Mouse and the No Tower book?
Well, when I did Mouse, I had no intention of teaching anybody anything or making the world better. It really just came out of being a cartoonist, something that happened to me from the age of 8 on or so. And when I turned 30, I grew up in a generation that was told you can't trust anybody over 30. And I figured I was supposed to be dead in a motorcycle accident by then, and I hadn't even learned to ride a motorcycle yet. And so I figured I should take on a big challenge. And the challenge to me seemed to be to make a long comic book that would need a bookmark. There wasn't much of a model for such a thing. And because I work kind of slowly and with difficulty, it had to be a story worth telling. But that was all I was looking for. It wasn't trying to tell a story that would make people kinder and better in the world or improve things, except maybe comic books. Much to my astonishment, the book landed much better than certainly my publisher thought it was going to. Mouse, I was warned, would only sell 3,000 copies, and by God, they'd be very proud of it because it was a good book. And I found since then that Mouse has become included in lots of courses and has become kind of a benchmark for a certain approach to comics. But none of it had to do with teaching people about the Holocaust per se, except me. Taking on a long story for me, ended up trying to figure out the Oedipal mystery of how I got born when I had two parents who were supposed to be dead. And the one thing that I do overlap with Marjane about was trying to find the specific anecdote that can make something larger known. Because comics are a very small medium. It doesn't allow for these broad sweeps. It's more like movies and showing a moment to a moment rather than large generalized paragraphs. And as a result, I found myself trying to read up about the Holocaust at a time where there wasn't the same inundation as there is now of a lot of literature and a lot of history even. When I first started a version of Mouse in 1971, I was able to read everything in English in about 3 weeks through interlibrary loans at my college. As a result, at the time, I had to scrutinize and study fairly carefully, travel to find back to Poland to try to understand what had happened and what I was trying to draw, and ultimately found that as a kind of professional deformation, in order to not get freaked out every time I had to read about the death camps, I was only following my parents' story. So if it happened in Bergen-Belsen, had nothing to do with me, it wasn't real. It was just a matter of trying to follow their very personal trajectory and hope that that could get written larger through the small examples. No Towers was something else again. It was a case where I wasn't witnessing two parents who had been badly damaged and from another culture, but witnessing something directly, being in Lower Manhattan when the two towers tumbled around us. And originally just wanted to parse out what I saw as opposed to what I was finding on the television screen, the dissonance between that. And soon what was happening on the television screen was so wildly far afield from what I was understanding that I began to feel I was living through a kind of coup d'etat that was occasioned by those towers falling. And as I began to draw what my responses were, I found, if you recall, back in early 2002, a very unreceptive media environment for such information. It was really shut down. And so these pages primarily were appearing in Europe. They were appearing while I was living with the conviction that the other shoe was going to drop at any moment. There's certainly no point in working on something like a book. Even if I could work as fast as Marjane, I didn't think I'd live long enough to make a full book with 150 or 200 pages. So I just concentrated on one page at a time for these German, French, British publications that were letting me publish my No Towers pages. Then, as with what happens with most post-traumatic stress, even I quieted down, although after some of my friends and neighbors, and then began to think, well, if the other shoe's going to drop, it's taking longer than I thought, and that meant maybe I could try to figure out some way of making these oversized few pages into some kind of a more permanent thing like a book.
So, Marjane, I just mentioned unreceptive media. How do you feel about the fact that you are, on one hand, a representative of a country from the axis of evil when you're trying to enter into the U.S., and on the other hand, rather well-received, and your work is well-received in the U.S.?
Absolutely. I completely approve about whatever Art just said about the comics. The big difference between Art and myself is that he really comes from a culture of comic, and I really don't come from a culture of comic. It happened that suddenly I started making comics.
How come, actually? What made you choose that medium? I mean, Art has said that he was a cartoonist, and now he just said he had to find a story to tell. You said you wanted to tell the story. Why did you choose that medium rather than...
I think... With the images is two things that are really not separated in my head, and as a matter of fact, I have been drawing all my life, but all my drawings, they were in a way narrative. They were telling a story, because I think that in a comic, the drawing, they are not illustration that comes and illustrate what you have already said. The drawing of the comics, they're part of the narration. You actually write with your drawing. It's another way of writing. And for me, it was very obvious, because I'm really not good at prose. Whatever humor that I can have while I'm making the comics, when I write the prose, in a way, it becomes extremely serious and very tough and very heavy and not fun at all. And plus, I really lose completely my sense of humor, which I can do because of the images, because it gives me the permission to have enough distance with the story, which I cannot make with the words. And the work in general was very well received. I mean, the first time I came here, I was very scared to come, because, well, I had to wait about 2 months to get a visa, and then they made me a hell in JFK. And also they sent me to Texas. And for me, it was a very big deal, because, you know, I went to Texas and I said, okay, you have to shut up there. And then I went in there and I said, okay, maybe I shouldn't shut up, really. Maybe I should say what I have to say. And I was very scared that someone in the people, because, you know, they have all shotguns and these things, they would come and shoot me. And if they have shooted me, I would become a martyr of Islam, because I was killed with a camel. And that would be a whole ironical situation in my life, you know, to fight against something and then be killed by a cowboy and finish a martyr of Islam, a symbol for the Islamic Republic of Iran. That was really not convenient.
But don't you have a cousin in Texas?
Oh, yes, I have a cousin, not in the city I was. I was in Austin, and I have this crazy cousin of mine who had become a cowboy, and she wore cowboy shoes and hat, and I didn't want to meet her. That's why I didn't go to Dallas, actually. Because you have your family that they have been normal people, and then they go to the United States and they turn to have a ranch and have horses and, you know, look like JR in Dallas. But you don't want to meet these people, and I didn't want to meet her, and that's why I didn't go there. And so here was in Texas, and then the second time I came, and again it went very well. And also in places, you know, because I always thought that New York is a kind of very different place, which is a very different place. But I really thought that all over the country I would only see crazy people, which is not true. I mean, I have gone all over the country now, and I saw so many very interesting and interested people. And so far, this morning, for example, I was lecturing in West Point, in the, you know, and of course I said exactly what I thought, because, you know, I couldn't say it otherwise. I couldn't be in West Point and say, oh, dear soldier, please come and attack my country. We are waiting for you to liberate us. I couldn't say so. And even there, it was well received. And even the big major, I mean, I don't know how you call it, the old major, he told me that not only they're going to teach Persepolis, but they're going to teach embroideries, which is a very sexual book, and I don't know why they're going to teach embroideries in West Point, but he said that it will open the kids' eyes. Probably it will. So.
Well, actually, when I asked what you were going to say at West Point, you said it didn't matter, because it's going to be 500 or more young cadets, so they would just watch you move your lips, then go back to their dorm rooms and masturbate.
That was a secret.
On the other hand, you were recently telling me about your exchanges when you were in North Carolina with people there, and that was also your advice to them, you said.
Yes, exactly. I heard that there are places in North Carolina where the sex shops, they are forbidden, and but in the other hand, people, they can buy arms, which I don't understand. I mean, because I consider that all what is arms is really the continuation of the penis. I mean, this is what it is about.
The weapons.
Weapons. I mean, it's the continuation of the virility. So probably if people, they could have more of sexual tools, they would need less weapons.
You explained that to them?
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
I'm absolutely convinced about that. I mean, you shouldn't forget that I have lived about 4 years in Austria, very close to where Freud lived. So I'm, you know, I'm under the pressure of Freud in a way. But it's true. I mean.
But do you feel that any Iranian woman can go explain to people enrolled in North Carolina that they should masturbate more so that they don't need weapons? So it's only because you're a cartoonist that you can...
No, I think it is because I'm a cartoonist. Oh. Because, you know, if I was a writer, you know, a normal writer, you know, we have to sit in a certain way and always be like that, and each sentence that comes out of your mouth, that has to be very, very intelligent sentence. As a cartoonist, we have the privilege of, I'm talking about myself, to be once in a while a little bit like clumsy and stupid, and this is something that I like, you know. It's something that I don't want to give away, and I don't want to become serious. So since I have a humor about myself, and since I laugh about myself, then the people, they also give me the permission to do the same thing to them. So it makes it kind of easier.
It's actually one of the point of overlap between the bodies of work is that you both have a sense of humor. And I know that when you come to France, people compare you to Woody Allen, and they have a hard time telling you apart. And they just assume there's a Jewish sense of humor. Do you feel that Marjane is displaying an Iranian sense of humor?
She's the only Iranian I know, so it seems like a very Iranian sense of humor to me.
Do you feel that you were talking at some point about specific, honest approach to personal lives that you felt was an Iranian trait?
Well, the sense of humor, that means, you know, I mean, it has happened so many things to this country since ever. I mean, since the history of this country start, we are either in war and we are mostly attacked. And, you know, I mean, there are Arabs that came, there are people of Mongolia that came, the Turks, they came, and then, you know, that was the new imperialism, the British, they came, the American, they came, the Iraqi came. So, I mean, this country has all the time been attacked, and it has all the time been... lots of, you know, murdering in this country. And I think the only way these people, they survived and they could survive, it was to keep this sense of humor. Because everything that happened in Iran about a couple of days after, that was jokes about it, and we could laugh about it, and that's why we could survive. I think, I mean, when there are, you have this tremendous amount of things that happen, you either have to say, okay, it's too much and I will die, or then you have to laugh about it and to continue living. And that is probably what Iranian people, they have decided to do, to laugh about it and to joke about it. So it's true that I have a very Iranian sense of humor. I think I do.
And you feel maybe that humor of the oppressed people, so I guess that's a salving race.
One thing that I really like in Marjane's work is it verifies one more time that comics are a very intimate and flexible way to work, and that the thing that won me over, both to Persepolis and especially to embroideries, is it really seems like an extension of talking with you. When you said your work came from, you're trying to tell stories and there's a way to get the stories told without being interrupted, it seems that part of what every comics artist I've ever admired has had to do is sort of reinvent what comics are. It's not the same for Jules Pfeiffer as it is for Will Eisner, as it is for whoever. They each have to find a different balance of words and pictures and how to make those pictures. And one thing I especially liked in embroideries was how relaxed it was. And that, in a way, it was more overtly and congenially an expression of your personality, because comics with a lot of panels involves a lot of compression of leaving a lot of things out and putting it in so that it's compressed to the point of needing to burst when you look at it. And there's this other thing that has a more kind of winding narrative that allows you to take side trips and meet other people and talk about whatever comes into your head. And I felt that in embroideries, where it felt more like a kind of calligraphic kind of making, where the drawing and the writing were very much one language, rather than trying to like work discreetly in the two separate ways and make them fit together.
No, absolutely. The thing was that embroideries was a really a long conversation, and you know, that was no way that I could put frame around the people, because a conversation is open and a conversation is fluid. In a conversation, you can enter whenever you want and get out whenever you want. You can interrupt the conversation. But I had to make the fluidity of the conversation in the form of the book, because, you know, I think that both of us, we agree that, you know, the images is our narrations too. So, you know, I couldn't make it differently. But then, you know, the big challenge in this book is about 150 pages, and they're all the time sitting in the same living room. So, you know, and the big challenge was for me in every page, because, you know, if you all the time draw the same people in the same living room, you know, after 15 pages, the people, they get bored and they don't want to read that anymore. I wouldn't read it anymore. So each page I had to think, how am I going to show them this time, that it wouldn't be a repetition of what I have already showed. So it's true that I wanted this fluidity in embroideries. But also, you know, I was probably more mature also when I did it.
Mm-hmm. You have said that you became more comfortable, more conversant with...
Had to live with, ultimately, for about 13 years to get the work done. And prior to that, all of my comics had been drawn in different styles from each other. Like in the inset into Mao's, there's a strip I had done earlier about my mother's suicide, and that's very affected by kind of German expressionist and woodcut style drawings. And it's a clue that the drawing in Mao's, which looks more intimate, more direct, was as much a choice as everything else. When I was working on the No Towers pages, which was really the first time I was willing to like seriously go charging into doing comics again, because I've turned it into such hell working on comics that I tend to avoid it unless there's something I really need to do. And in the No Towers pages, I needed to do something, and one of the things I needed to do is express how fractured my brain had become. Like, instead of just being schizophrenic and having two selves talking to each other, I was now multiphrenic with like about 20 or 30 different personalities, each vying for the microphone. And as a result, there are a lot of different drawing styles and visual approaches all kind of collaged and wedged into each other. And that was a congenial way for me to find my way back into talking with a voice appropriate to the occasion. I'm starting something else now, and it's just as grindingly difficult as the other two projects. It doesn't seem to get easier for me as I get older.
No, it's not easier, because Art is right. For me too, I mean, in the other book that I have made that is not yet published here, Pulo Prune, that will come next year out, you know, the story is again different. So with a different story, you cannot use this, the same language. It's not possible. Each story needs a new language. So every time the big challenge is to say, how am I going to do it? And, you know, okay, for doing it, it doesn't take such a long time. But for thinking it, you know, everything is in my brain, so I have to think, so how am I going to do it this time? Because also repeating what you have already done is not very exciting for me. So
and now you're working on animation.
Yes, on an animation movie, and that proved me once forever that, you know, for people who say that comics are the, like the storyboards of a movie and they compare it all the time to the cinema. It has nothing to do. It has nothing to do. It's a complete different language. I mean, having to rewrite this whole scenario to make a movie scenario, I understood that it's two completely different language and it has nothing to do together. And this is a new challenge again. So we will see how it will be. I mean, it has happened that I'm a movie director now and I don't know how am I going to do it. So if in 2 years you see a movie, that means that it went well. But if you don't see a movie, that means that my producer, he has killed himself.
In both your work, you travels the intersection between the personal and the historical and the broader context. Do you feel that they are, even though your work is very much first person, and you talk about sex and sensual pleasures and so on, do you feel that there are certain things that you should not say?
Oh, I'm all the time censoring myself. I'm all the time doing that. I mean, if I really said whatever I thought, I wouldn't have any friend anymore in my life. I would be all alone. So, of course, there are lots of things that I don't say. I mean, for instance, for making the book Embroideries, I changed all the face and the names of the people. And, you know, the woman that has, for example, three children and the name of her husband is Hossein, for example. In reality, she has only one child and the name of her husband is something else and she doesn't look like herself, because these are the things that people, they wouldn't like to, you know, that other people would know about them. So, you know, I respect completely that. In reality, I just cannot do it otherwise. And normally in my books, when I'm really mean to people, I try to change their face and their names. Mm-hmm. And when I'm flattering them, I put their real face and names. But there is an exception. I mean, this Frau Dr. Heller, that is in the Persepolis 2, she was really mean, and she has her real face and her real name.
I was wondering about that, yeah.
But I mean, she was so mean that, I mean, what the hell? She can suffer of what I wrote.
Have you ever heard from people that were portrayed in your books?
Not really, no. Mm-hmm. No, because, as I say, I really change in a way that they wouldn't recognize themselves, or if they recognize themselves, that all
they
the people around cannot recognize them. And like that, you know, nobody can sue me and everything, because also we are in the United States and you can sue anyone for any reason, so it's a better thing, you know, to not
to make not get any lawsuits.
Exactly, and also, you know, it's a story, you know. I'm not making documentaries. It's a story, and, you know, the basis is real, and then I make up all the story around it. So,
and do you feel that that's a limitation, specifically in Mouse, because there was a mandate to follow the story as it?
Yeah, I envy Marjane's feeling of freedom. I feel very tethered to the reality I'm trying to depict in my work, and it can create real problems, like. In Mao's, the book was done, the publisher was getting ready to put it out and said, oh, you're going to have to get a release from your stepmother. And it really appalled me, because if she said, no, you can't do that, I was stuck.
The same concern about lawsuits, yeah.
Yeah, I couldn't, they wouldn't publish it unless the release came. So Françoise and I actually took Mala out to a restaurant around the corner from our house, got her a little drunk, and in principle she liked everything, but she hadn't read a lot of Mouse. She'd seen some of it as it was appearing in my Françoise and my small press magazine, Raw. And that evening, the main thing I remember about it is there were rats and mice all over the restaurant.
There were mice. They were not rats.
They were all over. Every place you look, there's a mouse right behind Mala's shoulder while I was trying to talk to her about how this book was going to come out. It was going to be very important for people to read such a thing.
But we'll change the name of the restaurant.
And ultimately, she signed without reading, and I think she had some regrets after. But for me, it's very difficult not to use the actual information. I begin to get lost as soon as something has to become fictitious, because then I feel like I'm playing tennis without a net. You know, like the real goal for me is to try to capture something in as concise a way as possible, but as, in its own way as accurately as possible, even though it's comics. And for that, as soon as I begin to let anything go, like say, oh, it won't be my 45-year-old pal who's a filmmaker, it's going to be some 30-year-old woman who's a painter that says this. As soon as I do that, I begin to lose track of what I'm making, you know, because at that point, let's see, it takes place in a hotel in San Francisco. No, a motel in Nebraska. No. And it becomes so arbitrary that I don't feel like I have my ground under me anymore. And it does become a problem because there are things I'd like to do that I know will get me, that can only be published posthumously.
Do you have stories that you would like to tell but you can't because of respecting people's privacy?
No, I don't think so. No, because as I said, I change them so much that even if they know who they are, nobody else around them can know who they are. I mean, people, they would know who they are themselves if they read the book. And so, you know, also you cannot always make things that will please to everybody. I mean, in life we always make people angry to us, and, you know, I don't like everybody, and I have admitted that not everybody should like me. So that has made my life much easier.
I'm very curious about the reception to your new book, to the embroideries book, because it's a new dimension in a way of interacting with people. Before, you were seen as someone who was giving information about what it's like to grow up in Iran, but now you are actually talking about the women's conversation and the women's discussion, and you're presenting a very frank discussions among the women about divorce, about arranged marriages, about their sexual needs and desire. And in the U.S., at least, it totally contradicts the ideas that we have of women, especially in Muslim countries. And what was the kind of responses that you got from feminists and from women per se?
Well, listen, I mean, first of all, this conception that they have about Muslim countries from the beginning is a wrong conception, because there is not such a notion like Muslim countries. It doesn't mean anything. Muslim countries, they go from Morocco to Indonesia, they go from Bosnia to Somalia. So it makes a lot of country with lots of different languages, with lots of different background. And saying Muslim countries is, in a way, giving too much credit to religion. That means, in a way, saying the only fact that gives a definition of a culture, of a society, is its religion, which is not. Religion is one of the facts that give a definition of a culture, but it's not the only one. There are so many more interesting things, like, for example, the geography of a place makes much more on the attitude of the people than their own, than the religion. So I'm not talking actually in the name of all the Muslim people. What I was trying, I mean, it was not trying. I mean, when I wrote Persepolis, I was just remembering, because since the goal of Persepolis, as I was saying, I was trying to show another face of Iran, I suddenly remembered that was so many nice thing, you know, that happens in Iran that I couldn't put into the book because it didn't fit to the subject at all. And I had to make a book for that. And also, that was, we are living in this moment of life where the notion of pleasure is completely denied. We are not talking about pleasure anymore. Whatever we are talking about is security. And the more secure we want to be, the more conservative we are going to be, because in order to be more secure, you have to conserve yourself. So it closed the mind. And I think, in the other hand, pleasure is something that we all share, and it's a way of opening. And today it has become really, I mean, it's kind of pervert that as soon as I say that I am a smoker, they will tell me, oh, you're going to get the lung cancer. But before getting the lung cancer, I'm going to have a pleasure for many years of smoking, and this is a pleasure. As soon as I say food, they would say, oh, you're going to get the cholesterol. But before getting the cholesterol, I'm going to enjoy eating a butter burger of Milwaukee. That is very tasty, actually. As soon as you say sex, they were related to AIDS and all the problem. But it's a pleasure, after all. And I wanted to talk about all this pleasure. So the funny thing is that in United States, you know, because of this culture of security and conservatism, we are even conservative about our physique, because we want to conserve everything, and we enter into this culture of youth that everybody has to look young, and from the second that you look young and you look performant, that you can do everything. And when you don't look young, you don't make part of the society anymore. And for me, it's a result of this, the security stuff, because when you conserve everything, you even conserve your physics. And I don't think that the pleasure of life stops when you get 50 at all. And I don't believe in this culture of youth. I think people, they get better by the age. I'm much better now that I'm 35 than when I was 20. And I swear, if they gave me, $10 million to be 20 again, never in my life I would be 20. Because, you know, even I was 20, you know, that was not my brain that was working. That was my hormones that they were leading, all my thoughts and everything, you know. That was the way I was. And today it's much more of my brain that shows me what I should do. And in my big surprise, because I was very much scared, you know, of, you know, because in America you have some very fierce feminists that, you know, they are really against, I don't say all the feminists, that it shouldn't be taken bad, but some of them, you know, I mean, you say, you know, I mean, the men, they are nice, and we like to kiss them, and they would say, oh, no, you know, they're our enemy, and I like to kiss them more. And in my very big surprise, you know, that was many American ladies they were relieved in a way that the main characters of embroideries, they were older women. They're about 75, 60, and they're talking about sexual life. And I saw in many of these small places, you know, these beautiful women coming, you know, 70 years old and blushing a little bit and saying, oh, yes, it's true. Sex is even important at our age. And, you know, and while I was talking, these ladies, they were blushing. And that is something good. And, you know, to remember people that, you know, we can also laugh and we can also talk about pleasure. And, you know, life is short. And let's enjoy it a little bit, because without this joy, why do we live at all?
Since Mouse has been published, it's been, which is now 20 years ago, there have been many comics, a lot of which I've had on the backs, the greatest comic book since Mouse. How do you feel about the fact that one of the challenging, interesting cartoonists who's now, you know, come onto the scene is an articulate woman from a different culture? Did you expect that?
I didn't expect Mouse to even get published, so I certainly couldn't have predicted anything like this. It's very nice to have a cousin.
Yes, but I have to say that, you know, I have to remind people, I mean, the way I met Art, because I met him in a festival in France, and then my book got published here. And of course, you know, at the second it was published, since it was in black and white and small format, they say, this is the new Mouse, and it was everywhere. And he gave me his the number to his studio, and I wanted to call him. And then I was so ashamed, you know, that he would think that it's me who is making this comparison, you know, to glue myself to him and to say, look, I'm as interesting as he is. It was not me. That was all the journalists that, you know, they probably they don't have enough imagination to make up something, so they always have to compare with something that already exists. And so I called him and I say, really, I'm extremely sorry, but you should just know that it's not me who is trying. It's the other people. And for me, of course I'm honored. And of course, you know, the book that made me become a cartoonist was Mouse. It is true, because I didn't have any idea about what comic was. That was when I read Mouse that I was like, oh my God, you can do that too. It is true, but in no way I would never compare myself to him, never. And that's the way we became friends.
Is that something that makes sense to use a link between Marjane's work?
There's more of a link with Marjane's work than with lots of the other comics that I see around. I also feel in some way some kinship with Chris Ware's work that doesn't look anything at all like mine, but also has a strong engagement with the formal parts of comics. But the fact that Marjane's work, that it so specifically goes out and starts grappling with the world instead of making some little hermetic cartoonist universe that avoids reality at all costs, or if it... there's a lot of things at this point that are called graphic novels, that are called comics, that really are a kind of genre fiction, that are really carrying primarily attitude rather than ideas or information. And so far, everything I've seen of Marjane's tries to engage with the world. And there's very few comics artists that are doing that. In his own way, I would say Joe Sacco is trying to do that, trying to engage with the world directly. But it's a small handful of people. And in terms of that first look of the intimate, of the small black and white drawings that are humble, I can understand how the journalists got there. My problem is that Mouse has now separated from me and become this monolithic 5,000-pound mouse that not only is this kind of snarling creature facing any other cartoonist trying to make a book of comics, it faces me as well. Whatever I do, I'm told, yeah, but it's not Mouse. You know? Well, yeah, I did that already.
Is there some version of that for you in terms of the response to...
Absolutely. I mean, when Persepolis was out, you know, I had two requests from New York Times, and the both time, you know, that was something about the coup d'etat that America made in 53. So that was the anniversary of that in August 2003, the 50th anniversary of this coup d'etat, and they told me to do something. So, you know, I made lots of researches and everything to be as precise as possible. And then I just sent them the draft. And the answer was that, yes, but where is the little Margie? I mean, I'm not the little Margie anymore. I'm a grown-up woman talking about a coup d'etat. And they stick, you know, they have seen this cute little girl, and so they want it forever. And I don't look like a cute little girl anymore, and I don't want to be it. And so, you know, it was a daily fight every time to say, I have already done Persepolis, and I'm not going to do Persepolis anymore. It's finished. I'm going to do something else now. But, well, you know, people also, they always want you to do what you have already done. It makes it more comfortable. But then you shouldn't do it this way. And they get used to it.
In the... medium of animated film. Are you doing something as personal as you did in your book?
Let's say it's very different, because first of all, I said the movie should be in black and white, and they say, oh, yeah, we are not going to make this kind of Danish dogmatism that it should be in black and white, and why in black and white, and it's not going to sell and all of that. So I had to find out a way. So it was actually something that I did two years ago. That means that, you know, since 5.5 years, I cannot go back to my country. And this day I was extremely nostalgic, and I was really, you know, and I that was Thursday night, and I made a little suitcase, and I went to the Orly airport to take Iranair to go to Iran, though I knew that I couldn't go. And, you know, I was staying in line, and well, you know, the guy told me your ticket, and I didn't have any ticket, and so I went up in the restaurant of Air Orly, and I saw Iranair flying, and so I stayed the whole afternoon there, and I cried, and so it was something, you know, I couldn't go, so I had to invent going. So the movie starts with that, which is in color, about 3 minutes, and the whole movie is a long flashback of one and a half hour of what happened. So nobody can accuse me of being a sort of Danish dogma. It's just a very long flashback. So that was the way I could handle it. But the scenario, in a way, it has changed a lot because, again, it's not the same narration, because you have to think it completely differently. It's a very big challenge. And the biggest challenge is that I have to work with 100 people, and I'm not used to. I've only worked with myself all my life, which was not easy to handle. So working with 100 people makes me very scared, but I will see.
Are you finding it rewarding so far, or are you also starting a new book of comics?
Oh, no, I'm making another book of comics, because the moment that you're making a book of comics is the most gracious moment of life, you know, when you're creating a story and you have to think about how you're going to say it anyway, in which form, and how you're going to invent the story. And this is a moment of life that is not comparable with nothing in the world. So of course I will keep on doing my comics forever. For me, these are tries that I make here and there, you know, because I say, okay, I will try to see what it is. But for me, you know, when I make the comics, it puts me, you know, I'm in the heavens, so, and I cannot compare it to anything else. So I will continue.
I'd like to hear your answer to that.
To what?
What you feel like when you are starting a work of comics.
Oh, it doesn't bring elation. I think what happens is everything one does is to avoid something else that's harder. And so usually I start doing comics because not doing it would be even worse.
Exactly.
And for quite a few years, actually, I was kind of tempted to try all these other things, where I was saying it's a lot easier to write than to write and draw together. It's a lot easier to draw, so I'll just do one picture, like a cover of a magazine, because at least I don't have to do 20 to get my idea across. And I also had this kind of interest in collaborating, but I was totally afraid of doing it with cinema. Mainly because I felt like there was so much money riding on a film that they would never give you the opportunity to move around and not debate you. So even though there were lots of offers for Mouse, I really genuinely was not interested in any of them. And in fact, fired my first agent when, despite my saying that, he brought this guy from L.A. who was just a cartoon version of the gold chains and the open hairy chest, and was saying, I'm going to make a movie, and when I said I wasn't interested, he just thought it meant that I wanted more money. Like, he didn't understand that I didn't want to make a movie. So my one attempt at collaboration was this kind of strange project that got mentioned when I was introduced, this Drawn to Death, a three-panel opera that's gone through various permutations, where I got to find out that even in the world of theater, where there's much less money involved, there's so little money available that everybody's just as uptight about losing $20 as they are at losing $200,000 in a movie. Nevertheless, I'm still sort of finding my way through what it might be like to work with other people. And usually the reason I'm happy to go back to doing comics is the autonomy, the fact that you can not have to answer to anybody except the piece of paper and your own skills or lack of same.
No, I mean, if I was living here, I would have given the same answer, because, you know, when the first Persepolis was published, I had this crazy email, like this people of L.A. who wanted to make a version of Persepolis, like this series that is called Beverly Hills, but in Iran, that, like, you know, we were like some Iranian rich kid, and ha 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 ha, we were on our fancy car, and a bomb get exploded, and ha 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 ha, we were on a party, and you know, and probably, I don't know, with the Brad Pitt playing my mother and Jennifer Lopez being my father and all of this. And I really couldn't understand why. I mean, did they read really the book? And because you cannot trust. And when you write a story like Mouse or like Persepolis, you have responsibility. You cannot just give it away. The fact was that I had two friends that they wanted to become producer that I know them forever. My co-scenarist and my co-movie maker, he's my best friend. So it's a very little, small production with people that I can have my hand over them. So they will listen to me, and I know that. If that was not in this case, I would never do it, never. So, but these are people.
Well, among the many offers I got, there was one person who just wouldn't let go and said, but you can have final cut. And I kept explaining that there wasn't anything to cut because it took 13 years to make it find its form as a comic. To start again and make it find its form as a movie wasn't going to happen. But you could have final cut. And I kept explaining that I'm not a moil, you know, I'm not. And one person at some point asked me, another director, producer, asked, well, if you were going to do it, how do you see it? How would you do it? And I said, but we're not doing it. I have no imagination. And then they said, well, if you were going to do it, what would you do? And then at that point, but this was a little bit before current technology, I said, well, let's do it with real mice. And that finally kind of made that particular offer go away until at some point Errol Morris heard about it and said, let's do it with real mice. And then my bluff was called.
You have talked about using your limitations. By that you meant your limitation as an artist. I mean, one of the hallmark of the intimacy of the story you tell is that your hand is very present, and you feel that you willfully incorporate the directness of the drawing.
Well, absolutely. I mean, you know, first the book was published. I mean, everywhere it was written, the false, naive style of Marjane Satrapi. And that was nothing false about my naive style. It was just naive. And the reason was that I couldn't draw better. This is the truth, because one thing that made the difference between the drawing in a comic and in normal illustration, you have to have the notion of movement. In an illustration, you never have, it can be static. But in comics, it has to be movement. But in order to know the movement, you have to know the anatomy. And I didn't know so much about anatomy because basically I studied art in Iran, and all the art models that are supposed to be naked, they were covered. So that was no way of seeing where the arm was and where the leg was. So it was not this easy. But at the same time, you know, I always have the feeling that I'm going to die tomorrow, so I couldn't wait another 5 years that I would draw very well, and then I would start making it. So I say, okay, I'm going to do it. And, you know, if I have to compare it, you know, it's a question of budget in reality. You know, you have people, you give them, I don't know, $300 million, they would make a movie called, I don't know, Terminator, which is a very bad movie, and they have they have a lots of money to spend on. Then you have other people that they make very nice movie with only $3 million. You know, I mean, Cassavetes didn't make movie with a very high budget. And they are masterpieces. The only thing is to know how much you have. And I always knew that I had about $300,000, so I couldn't lose a penny of it. I had to use each cent of it. So my style really came from the fact that I knew that I had lacks, and I said, okay, what the hell? Instead of waiting 5 more years, I will do it. And it happened that the story that I was saying was happening when I was a child. And as I was growing up, I knew how to draw better and better. And so the drawing, they had the same evolution with my age, but that was really, I was lucky. I cannot say it otherwise.
Well, you don't have the excuse of having models robed in burqas, but do you feel that was a conscious choice to use a simple drawing style?
For Mouse specifically? Yeah. I mean, I find in general, like, I think I've mentioned it a few times already this evening, how arduous the drawing part of this thing is. I really like the planning, the thinking through of what's going to happen, and the actual time to draw is just sort of this necessary evil. My problem is I can't get somebody else to draw it because they won't draw wrong the right way, you know?
Exactly.
But for each project, I've had to figure out how to do this. And when I was working on Mouse, I didn't know what it should look like. I just knew approximately what I was going to do. And while I was breaking the story down, finding out what could be on what page, what graphic ideas could hold the pages together, I was drawing without thinking much about drawing. It was just trying to make notations for myself. And then I would have this other set of projects which were like graphic researches. Maybe I could draw it like Eastern European children's books with scratchboard. Maybe I could do it more like an animated cartoon style. Maybe this, maybe that. And everything I tried seemed to ring hollow until I finally like accepted the fact that the rough sketches were already very much on the right track, because they didn't put the artifice between me and the reader. The idea that, you know, if I did draw it like an Eastern European children's book style of drawing with this nice engraved look, I'd be kind of maintaining that I had a certain kind of authority that the reader doesn't have. Like, shut up, I know how to draw and you don't, so just shut up. And I didn't want that. I wanted something much more intimate. And that intimacy was partially achieved by drawing the same size that it was printed, so that the mark I make was the mark that you see, for example. And the only thing that was wrong with my rough sketches is that they were too expressive, and therefore they weren't as precise as I needed. So then I had this thing that was at least as difficult as drawing this engraving style, which was trying to find something that both looked casual and would be not so expressive that it couldn't have the precision necessary to show what had to happen.
Yes, and the artifice that the artist is talking about is true, because, you know, in a comic, each image, you read the images. So the more you add, you know, like every other thing that you add, it's an extra information. So everything you add, you will the person who will read your book will read it too. So you completely break also the rhythm of reading. So if you want to have an intimate thing, the less you put, the better it is. So.
Well, it's one of the things that was really always not working. Do you have Fumetti's? In France you have it, right? The photo comics.
Yes.
Yeah, and photo comics tend to not work very well because photos just carry a lot of extra data, what's in the room, for example. And so when you try to read a photo comic, it's actually not as easy a glide as when you're reading a comic where that work is kind of already done for you by the artist. My problem has always been, though, that in order to get there, I've had to do, like, very often, like 20, 30 drafts for each box. And that has to do with removing the extraneous stuff and seeing how little you need. And it becomes a little bit, unfortunately for me, it becomes a little bit as if I was trying to design a typeface, you know, like getting it down to its real essential linguistic form.
It's not quite as arduous for you, the drawing part. You were talking about the elation.
Don't worry, it'll get harder.
No, but it gets harder. It gets harder by the time, because when I made the two first book, I was in a way really naive, and you know, I was just doing it, and then in the Pulu Pun, the problem was really another problem, because I was going, you know, the story is the story of this musician that his instrument get broken, and he tries to buy a new instrument, and he buy four or five of them, and no instrument makes the music that he wants. So he decides to die, and so he lies down, and 8 days after he dies. And the story is about these 8 days. And in all these 8 days, you have a flashback, but you also have things that will happen in the future. But, you know, and the big challenge that was to think, okay, how am I going to do that and not saying all the time, and 10 years before that, he thought that, and in 20 years, that it would become obvious. So the more you know, of course, the more it make it complicated. It's true. But I let I let very much my instinct go. So, you know, it happens that I have made the whole page and I'm completely unsatisfied with the page, and so I will start over. But I trust my instinct in a way. So I just, that's what makes it a little easier probably.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned you grew up in a culture that didn't have comics, and you moved to France, a culture that certainly has a thriving industry of comics, and you have managed to carve for yourself a very unique place, I must say, in the French publishing world. your work is actually with mouse, one of the ones that has reached outside of the devotee.
Only having the text, you know, I mean, you get, for the price of one, you get two things, you know, you have the drawing and the writing. So I never underestimated that. And, you know, I was really completely naive. And then, of course, in France, you have this whole school, you know, of French comics that I didn't know really, neither. So, and probably that is something that helped me because I had to invent my own language for myself because I didn't know anything. So, of course, it helped me a lot because I didn't have the same, you know, most of the cartoonists, they have their tick, you know, it's like they would redo the same thing and they have references of this and that, and I didn't have all of that. So I had to remake my own language, and that is probably what helped it. But of course, you know, when I became famous, they said, first that they said that that was because I was a woman, then that was because I was coming from the third world, then because I was an ethnic phenomena, and all of that. I mean, maybe in some places I can be considered as an ethnic phenomena, but you know, when the book is translated in China and in Korea and you know, you can read it in Chile and in all these countries who don't care at all about my ethnicity, then probably something else also behind the work that is more interesting. I mean, before I was very humble and I would say, yes, excuse me, I'm this woman who come from the third world and all of that. Today when they say, oh, and why do you think your comic has succeeded? And I think, because before everything, I think it was a good book.
Do you think that
his book is a very good book? So you know,
the fact that you were from, to say the least, an immigrant family when you were growing up, has that given you the point of view of the outsiders that you were able to look at things in?
I guess. I mean, it sort of comes with the American Jewish territory anyway. American Jews are very proud of being outsiders, even when they're totally embraced by the culture. And I think it's probably an element of it, but I would say that a lot of what shaped me was Mad Magazine, rather than my immigrant status. It was the notion of looking at things from the outside and trying to be wised up about what you're seeing.
I think we should open it up to questions, if anybody as a question, we have about 10 or 15 minutes.
Yes. The question is for you, actually, and it is, what do you expect of the West Point cadets to get out of your book?
Well,
and then the second question is, what
could
you
repeat this question?
Okay, yeah, the first part of the question is, what would you expect the West Point cadets to get out of your book? And the second part is? What would you hope for they would get?
Well, listen, what today happened in West Point that was beyond whatever I could expect in my life. That was really beyond. First of all, I was sure that I was going to meet some Nazis. I mean, that was my point of view. I mean, the military people, and they were extremely close-minded, and all these people, they were soldiers, and they were brainwashed, and this and that. I went with this idea. And then here, I spoke in front of, 600 cadets. And of course, I told them really what I thought. And that means that, you know, I told them what I feel about the American government. I told them what I felt about war. I told them that they shouldn't make the war. I told them that life was enough short, that it's no reason to make it shorter. And I also told them that the democracy is not something that happened over a night. This is not a wallpaper that you glue on the wall and suddenly you have a democratic country. And it's surely not a present that you give to people with bombing them. And the response was unreal. And that was the first time that after a speech I cried because I was so moved. Because suddenly I could see all these young men, because they're very small, all of them. You know, they're 18, 19 years old, you know, they have pink cheeks. And I could see that suddenly all the doubts that they had themselves, suddenly someone came and told them, you have the right to have all this doubt, because it's a question of difference of point of view. And that was what I wanted to say, tell them that was when you see it from your point of view, you think that you have to do it, but see it from our point of view, and maybe you can have a second thought. And I don't know how much I changed them, but they changed me a lot, because that was the first time that I realized that in despite of the fact that I was considering myself as a very open-minded, nice person, I was very close-minded and I was much more stupid than what I thought. And it made the world around me much more complex, because saying all the military people, they're shit, it makes life very easy. Then you don't have to think about it. When you see that are human behind that, and these humans, they're much more intelligent than what you can think, and they have much more doubts than you can think, then it becomes something completely different. And as a result, when those kids came, I mean, I had plenty of them who told me, well, from today, we are not going to think the same way. And before going, I said, if I can put doubt in two of them, just two of them, if they can doubt about what is happening, then I have done what I had to do. But when I had all these responses, it became like not only maybe they doubt about the situation, but also I know today that I will never look at a soldier as I'm going to look at them as I used to do. I mean, I learned that most of these kids, they are going to be sent to Iraq. And what was very well touching was that the major said to Françoise that the good thing about this discussion was what I said about life and how short life is, and maybe they would think that their lives worth being lived too, and maybe they shouldn't finish it at the age of 20. So people, they were extremely open-minded, and that was a big surprise to me. It gave me belief that, you know, democracy, somehow the democracy still function. You know, that me as the representative of the axis of evil being in an institution like West Point is just impossible. It's just, you know, you cannot imagine that that would ever happen. And it happened because they wanted me to go there. And above all, they're going to teach embroideries in West Point.
They normally choose a different country every year, and because of the extraordinary response they got to Marjane's books, they will teach it again next year.
So, and the thing is that, really, for me, from today, my life is not anymore the same, because today made my life even more complicated, because I cannot have a completely definitive idea even about the thing that I hate the most, which is the war and all these guns and the power stuff. It made it even more complicated, and it has changed my life, actually.
It's certainly more complex than what you had said to Art earlier about, oh, they'll just go back to their room and masturbate. Yeah.
Oh,
it's
yes.
It's not as simple as all that.
Absolutely not. And you know, before I was making some joke and I couldn't prepare anything, and I was, you know, and you go there and you say, okay, if I say and the President Bush is not right, are they going to tell me, shut up, lady, go out, we don't want you here? And it was not of that. They were very well educated. They were much more receptive to me than I was to them. And I learned to become receptive to them while I was talking to them. So, yes.
I have two questions. I think the first one is to you. How did you manage to send Marjane to West Point?
Oh, I didn't. No. They actually approached her.
And the other question, okay, so then if you could answer, how could you just convince her? The other question, is there any symbolism in your ring? Really exceptional wealth that you have here?
No, there is no symbolism. It's a place close to my house that they make it, and I like big jewelries. There is no symbolic in anyhow. And it fits with my dress, and you noticed it and everything. But, you know, the thing was that last year I was in this place, this bar called Lolita Cafe, downtown Manhattan, in East Village. And here it was this guy, completely shaved, very muscular, very high, very, very... And he came and he said, "Hello, I'm Major Kerr Brown from West Point, and I want to invite you to because I teach your book." And I was thinking, this is a pervert who has come here because the place is a lesbian cafe. And I was saying, yeah, that's it. Sick pervert, go back to your house. And I didn't believe one second that he was a major at all. And I even said it. I told him the story today that I thought that he was a pervert.
The cadets were delighted to hear that their major had gone to a bar in the Lower East Side.
Exactly.
They didn't know.
And then they contacted my publicist, Michiko, and that was the gate. But until today, until this morning, I didn't understand how incredible it was. I was joking about all this masturbation stuff and the cadets and haha. And this morning when I woke up, I never had a sour stomach like that in my life. So that was when I understood that, wow, it's something important happening there. And
learned from them that they have no problem getting politicians to come and address the cadets. It's on their route for their career. It's good for them. But they have a much harder time getting writers and literary figures to come.
This is a question for Art. I was wondering when you did the DVD with Mouth, I was wondering if you felt like you wanted to add any more since that had been out, and if you now that there were more things and more technological events, because that was so amazing. That was such a great supplement to the work.
The question's about the CD, right, of the making of Mouth's CD that included sketches and whatever. Well, when I first said yes to the project, the main thing I didn't want was some kind of ersatz, low-budget animation where, like, you know, they'd be on the trains and they'd be waving with two frames and flash going back and forth. And on the other hand, what got me really interested in doing the project at all was at that time CD-ROMs were like a new technology, and there were all these ads saying, every painting in the Louvre on this one disc, you know? And I thought, great, because I produced so many pieces of paper to get down to the 300 or so that were Mouse, it's a place to put all that stuff. And then I found out I had lots more pieces of paper than there are paintings in the Louvre. And I was really kind of disappointed to find out that they were going to have to make a very edited selection of things. And even at the time, although they invented new compression technology to accommodate my needs for this CD, I couldn't even include the full recording of my father's conversations with me, where I had taped those things and used them as my master guide for what I was going to be making. All we could do is include excerpts of it and the prose text. At this point, CD-ROMs aren't really like a hot item anymore. The internet came along and wiped it out as a medium. But it would be too hard to go back and rethink and redo that whole thing again. It was just an enormous task to weed through all that stuff. So now it's going to be a DVD where they found a way. It was done originally on something called HyperCard, which is now like Sanskrit. It's a dead language. And now they found a way to mount the former CD, which is out of print but gets bought by a lot of colleges to use it when they're teaching mouths. They figured out a way to make it do its thing without HyperCard on a DVD. And to that, we can add the recordings in their entirety. And that'll be part of a project I'm doing for next year, which is a book called MetaMouse, which is a collection of sketches and drafts and the documentation and the transcript of my conversations with my father. And it'll have this accompanying DVD to bring that out in the world again.
I'm sorry to say that we can only take one more question, but this is so that Marjane then has a chance to sign books, and you'll be willing to sign books. And then she has to leave. So there'll be about 15 minutes after one last question.
Thank you for smoking. really. And I'm glad to hear that you're not underestimating the United States of America. I'm a lot like you. I was born in 1963 in Neshobur. I came here in 1982, lived in Philadelphia, moved to New York in 90, and since then I've been here working, and I don't have like a whole lot. I only have any selective contact with Iranian community. A friend of mine But your
I'm sorry, I just do have to ask you to make one short question so she can answer. Sorry.
A friend of mine bought your book for his little children who, like, probably go to the 92nd Street Y. And, you know, one thing that I thought was powerful about your book was the fact that it was really not for children at all. There's stuff that's quite disturbing, even though it's presented in the form of a comic. And, you know, I get the sense that Iranian people don't like to admit that certain things that are in your book ever took place. Do you get that sense at all? That's the question.
Well, listen, I mean, when I actually wrote those books, I knew that many people, they might not agree with me, because if you're a royalist, then you cannot be my friend. If you are, you know, a fanatic, you cannot be my friend. Nobody can be my friend. So in a way, I thought that I would get a huge attention of the Iranian community, and that was not the case, actually. I mean, I was in LA, I went into an Iranian bookstore, and that was three people coming. And the day after, I went to an American bookstore, and that was 100 people coming. So it is for sure. But at the same time, I have had so many Iranian also that they have related completely to the story. So many of them. So, of course, it's bothering. But the only way for us to make a better Iran tomorrow is to admit what has happened. You know, for instance, you know, I always say, yes, American, they made a coup d'etat in my country in 53. But American, they couldn't do the coup d'etat in my country if that was not some Iranian working with them in Iran. So, you know, the American did it, but with our help. We could also not help them. So in order to grow up, we have to admit our mistakes. That is what I try to do. So if some people, they might not agree with me, this is not bad neither. We don't have to have the same point of view about everything. And that is what makes life better.
Okay, great last words. Thank you very much. And I'm sorry to say that Marjane will have to leave after 15 minutes.
Je l'ai pas vu.
How are you?
It's my class. Swiss hotel. Panjo Shish and Park Avenue.
Okay, honey.
Let me give you
my number. Let me give you my number just in case.
Do you
want me to give
you the number of your phone to your friend?
No, no, elle va me donner son portable et j'ai mon portable.
Right here?
Yes.
Oh, ton portable est là.
Ah, mais elle en met quand même.
That's my cell phone.
Je vais lui donner les informations. Ne t'en fais pas.
Honey, I'll see you then.
فداچم میبینم ات قربونت رو برم.
How could I contact you best?
Okay. You know, the best is that you write me an email, and my email is very simple.
Put it down. Are you available in fall?
In fall, yes. Normally, yes.
Chiara's family will come to, and I would love to have you come to.
Well, yeah? With pleasure. I know him.
Yeah. Okay.
So, yes. It's like
20 minutes. I know him very well, and okay, we get along very well.
Okay, fine.
So,
thank you so much.
Because he is a great man, this Major Brown, he is my friend.
Can you write this to Yvonne? Dear Yvonne? Yvonne.
When are they going to start? When are they teaching this?
They taught it last year.
من خیلی خوشم اومد از پرسپولیس.
Hi. It's very nice to see you. I love all your books.
Thank you so much. I have to make it kind of quick because
unless
I have to leave.
Thank you so much though.
Thank you.
Okay.
Hi.
My wife is such a fan of yours.
What's her name?
Barbara.
Barbara.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for having come. Hi.
I brought all your books.
You did the right thing.
Good luck with your movie. I hope it goes well.
I hope you
Hi there.
Hello.
I enjoyed this a lot. It made me laugh.
Thank you a lot. Thank you for having come.
Thank you. Hi, salam.
Salam. Yes, I can.
Of course. I give your books to all my friends. I don't own
them, so. Okay, yes.
Thank you so much for having come.
Can I get a photo with you?
Yes.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hey, my name is Sarah. I met you in Sarah.
Is Sarah?
Yeah. That's right. I met you in Angoulême, but I'm sure you meet tons of people.
Yes, but your face, tell me something. I remember you.
Okay, I'm working with Mark Siegel, so I think
you
should
have. I remember.
I'm totally looking forward to your book.
Thank you.
Hi. I'm a friend of Samina Shahidi.
Yes.
And she wants you to know that she's presenting a paper on syphilis at the University of Chicago.
Oh.
I think next, sometime soon.
I'd talk to
you. What's your name?
Paloma.
P-A-L-O-M-A?
Yes. Thank you so much.
Hi.
Hi.
Sorry. Hi, my name is Araby, and I don't have my book for you to sign, but we looked at Garbage Pail Kids when I was a kid in Ohio, and we thought we were, like, the baddest things ever. And also, I got a copy of Mouse when I was, like, in middle school from a neighbor, and it really, I mean, it was totally different from anything we had seen, you know, from history books, from comic books, anything, and it really, you know, it meant a lot.
Well, that's part of why it took so long,
uniqueness.
Is I didn't have a model for it when I was doing it, you know?
And, I mean, I think I was kind of like, I always felt like it was a totally, I mean, it was this neat comic format to look at that was, like you said, different from all the superheroes, and, you know, like, I was the girl in the neighborhood, and I was like, this is really, you know, like, historic novel reading, or, you know, like, history book reading, comic book, so it was really different, but I brought you a book.
Oh,
I don't have it.
Great.
But it's a new publication from Insight Press. It's the memoir of Bob Lincoln, the chairman of the Revolutionary Communist Party. So all the information about the press and the book are in there.
Very nice. Thank you very, very much.
Yeah, no problem. Our pleasure.
I played around just
Hello.
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 How are you?
Oh, I am fine. I was so happy to hear you.
I'm so happy
I'm
that you
I'm an illustrator and a children's book writer.
Oh.
And I just enjoyed what you said so much. You know, it meant so much to me.
Thank you. What is your name?
Vera.
V-E-R-A.
Yeah, that's true. That thing you talked about, the excitement of making the pages come to be, you know. So wonderful.
Thank you very much. Am I done? No.
Well, thank you very much.